here. And the rest of you guys, why don't you sit here?
Good morning. Good morning, and thank you for joining us for the Art Basel final conversation of the week. This one is Rethinking Kunsthalles and Nonprofits, and I'm very happy to introduce Marc-Olivier Wahler, who not only is a founding director of the Chalet Society in Paris, but also curated the beautiful Robin Meyer show at the Volkshaus, which you should see as well. But let's go.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for waking up so early on Sunday morning. I think it means we have only like passionate people in this room, which is really great. And also, I think, interesting in the future of Art Center, which is our topic today. And today we have absolutely great speakers here. I'm so happy everyone could join. So I will just start to present speakers here, just on my left, Samuel Leuenberger, who is the director of SALTS, you probably know it, here in Basel, who started 5 years ago as a kind of salon and grew up more and more in Basel as an art center. Next, you have Elena Filipovic, which I'm sure you all know from Kunsthalle Basel, which I won't present, of course. Everyone knows what the Kunsthalle here is and what the Kunsthalle means in Basel and in the art world. Solveig Øvstebø, if I pronounce right, who is the director of the Renaissance Society, who this year is celebrating his 100th years, I just learned, which is, of course, a legendary art space in Chicago, and is really, I think, United States, a great model of Kunsthalle or art center. And then you have Anthony Huberman, who is the director of Wattis Institute, contemporary art in San Francisco, who started 3 years ago there, and who is doing an amazing program. We'll have time to go over it during our speak. And then you have Matthew Higgs, who is the director of the White Collins in New York, and who has been running the White Column for quite a few years now. I think we started together 10 years, okay? Even more, no? 10 years, okay. I thought a little bit more. So I'd like to start a little bit this conversation, I would say, with a kind of like a general thought on Kunsthalle. I mean, the Kunsthalle is a 19th century emanation. It has been started by artists in, reaction to the museum. They needed a space for artists, artists who are, for example, emerging artists, artists who need to present things that would dodge a little bit the art market. So they needed an alternative to museum. Almost 200 years ago, you saw the emergence of such art center, Kunstverein, Kunsthalle, etc. So I think it's almost 200 years old, a Kunsthalle. So the question is, do we have to think about the future of Kunsthalle? If we think about what a museum is doing nowadays, what a gallery is doing nowadays. I mean, the museum step a little bit on the tools of the Kunsthalle by organizing temporary exhibitions, not collection-oriented exhibition. The gallery started to also produce artworks that maybe are not always meant for the market. So in between, you always had the Kunsthalle, you had these three models before. I mean, the museum for the collection, the gallery for the market, and the Kunsthalle for a kind of in-betweenness to produce artwork that wouldn't be ready, I would say, for a collection. But nowadays, we see that these three models blurred a little bit. So we have to think a little bit about the identity of the Kunsthalle. That's why we have this title, Rethink Kunsthalle. So my first question is, do we have to think about a new model of the Kunsthalle? Which means, is there a new role for curators, a new format for exhibition? So I would just start on my left, just asking about the role of the curator. Samuel, you've been also, I think, assuming different type of roles during your career in the market, in, I would say, in a more intimate space as a salon, which would like trigger conversation, and then more into a public space. So you experience already this blurring of categories. So I think it's good to start with you.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, I mean, I think I'm the only one here running an off space. Salz is a project space that I started 5 years ago here on the outskirts of Basel with my former partner and an artist out of Zurich. And we kind of, like you said, we started as an art salon. And we started as an art salon exactly out of these different experiences that I had in the past, working previously as an expert at a large auction house, Christie's, or as is the assistant curator to Beatrix Ruff at the Kunsthalle Zurich, and also at a gallery in London. And so I really was interested in actually reshaping or trying to find out what it means to start at the very bottom again, in a space that starts in your living room and where you can actually enjoy the presence of the artwork in the most intimate setting. So we started in our home and actually started really just with dinners and very small exhibitions. Now, over the course of 5 years, it really changed a lot. But I think it's interesting what you said before. I think it's true that the forms have changed vastly the last 10 years. 10 years ago is when Beatrix started museum-like shows in the Kunsthalle. It's the same time where the Kunsthaus Zurich started showing contemporary, very young artists. You have just recently the Gegenwartsmuseum here in Basel who started their own project space. So there is this, you're right, there's this branching out where everybody wants to reach a most versatile audience possible. But I think what's most crucial is the audience that you want to target really at the end, because what you're saying, these crossovers, if a gallery does a museum-like or institutional show, they're still catering to entertain their client base, to sell the work in the most possible and impressive way. So I think it's really a question of the statues of the institution, of each institution, and what their outreach goal is. That really defines it.
Thank you. Elena, you experience also, I would say, two types of exhibition. You've been active in Biennale, like the Biennale of Berlin. You run an art institution. I would say, I'm tempted to say that a Biennale or even like an art fair is more like event-oriented. It's happened only once, of course, every year for an art fair, or every 2 years for a Biennale, versus, I would say, a Kunsthalle or an art institution that has a program and building a lining up of shows after shows, which build a narrative that I would say is unfolding over the years. Is any difference for you between these two models, I would say like a more event-oriented exhibition like a Biennale or building a program in a Kunsthalle?
Sure. It's very different, but I don't know if I would make the comparison necessarily between the biennial and the art fair. While it is true that both have a short temporality, I mean, the temporality of a biennial would be that of an exhibition, and because the nature of a biennial is that it's every time organized or usually always with a different curator, there isn't this sense of building up a program, which is very different. It's something I think everyone sort of seated here today is involved in an institution that is thinking not only in terms of the one event we might have on at this very moment, but how that creates a dialogue with what came before it, whether or not we were the curator. I mean, I'm the one on the panel who's the newest to my institution. I've been at Kunsthalle Basel about 8 months now. And the dialogue is with a program that I want to build over the future, but it's also with a dialogue with the 175-year history of the institution itself. And in some ways, I would say, having been a biennial curator, it's also this same sense of conversation with the ghosts of the biennial's past and kind of articulating something within space and time for the present, for the city that it happens to be in. And that's something I think that's biennials and small-scale arts institutions, and maybe museums, that's something that they share, that they have to think of a program that deals very much with an idea of internationalism, an audience. I mean, for me, the biggest international moment is these days, exactly, but I also have to think of what makes sense and what can be an interesting dialogue for my public, my, I call it my public now, but it's now my public locally.
Thank you. So, Solveig, you've been running an art institution in Europe, Bergen, and now you're running an art institution in Chicago. Is there for you, before talking about this blurring of categories, but for you, is there a difference between what we title this Kunsthalle, but is there for you a difference between running an art space in Europe and United States? I wouldn't tell about the structure, but more in terms of the type of exhibition or the type of program you could build.
Actually, not in this institution that I'm running. The Renaissance Society is very much like a Kunsthalle, like a Europe. It's structured like a European Kunsthalle. So for me, it was very similar for what I was used to in Bergen. I ran that space for 13 years, where you would have total freedom as a director to program and to decide the program and the artistic content. And that is the same at the Renaissance Society. Obviously, the structure of funding is different, where it's a much more individual. You know, you have to target individuals in the city and in the country and build on that, whereas in Norway you would have a much more closer connection to public funding and the governmental funding. So in that sense, it is different, absolutely. But the Renaissance Society is absolutely in this in-betweenness that you're talking about, where it has the structure of a Kunsthalle, but it's called a non-collecting museum. And it is at the university, but it's not a university gallery. And it's not called a Kunsthalle because we don't necessarily use that term in the States, but it still has the same structure as for we produce work, we present contemporary artists that is not necessarily broader known. So it has a similarity in many, many ways.
Okay, thank you. In terms of exhibition, do you think there is more and more a kind of trend towards an event oriented? Do you feel it with the, I would say, the way things evolve in the art world, having this kind of like event oriented exhibition or like event that takes the form of an exhibition. Do you feel a pressure on art institution to take this into account, or you feel a little bit that the Kunsthalle is strong enough to resist to this pressure?
Yeah, it's strong enough. Well, I don't feel the pressure of that necessarily. I do think that it is necessary for us who run this institution and who is responsible for creating the best possible frames for artists to work within. If we're running a museum, if we're running a Kunsthalle, if we're running an artist space, we just need, in the complexity the art world presents today, it's a cliche, but it still is the truth that it's exploded, the art world, and we still need to then, I think more than before, more than just 20 years ago, we need to have go up and look down and figure out what our role can be with the institution that we run, and see where we can be most relevant, where we could be most you know, serve what we're supposed to do in the best way. And the event, I think that is not something, I can just talk for me, but I don't think so much about that. I think about what the artists want to do and what kind of exhibitions they want to present. And then obviously we are a flexible and we're a smaller institution, we're a nimble institution, so we're able to create a program around those exhibitions, which has the more sort of an event character, where you have, you know, lectures and events and concerts and poetry reading and that kind of. So it's more to build up around the fact that we are making those projections and productions and yeah.
Thank you, Anthony. I know we've been working together in Paris, Palais de Tokyo. Of course, I followed everything you did, and I know you're very interested in the medium of exhibition. How do you feel being now at the Wattis Institute? How is there any future of the exhibition that is, I mean, in its kind of structure, in its identity? Is there an evolution, or is the exhibition meant to be what it is and just be what it will be structured by artists? Or is there thought within an institution, especially within an art center like the Wattis, where a curator could build, shape, think about the future of the exhibition?
Yeah, I think that, you know, the Wattis, you know, speaking about trying to figure out what would be a category that fits into what you were speaking about, those blurred boundaries between the existing category, you know, the word that, for obvious reasons, I've thought a lot about in terms of what it means and how it can relate to exhibitions and or events is the name of my organization, is this word institute. And what does that refer to, and what is that? And the way I've tried to interpret it and how it steered me both towards and away from exhibitions is the kind of two aligned, you know, manifestations or definitions of what that word usually refers to, because in the art context it refers to a Kunsthalle or an art center, an ICA basically, but then in the academic context, which the Wattis is, operates under the umbrella of a university, that word also appears and it means something very different. It refers to a kind of private, small scale think tank, kind of research institute. And so I, you know, in terms of, and that is not really exhibition driven. That happens much more between about convening a group of people who are gathering together under the rubric of trying to think through something very specific, usually for a longer period of time. And so my approach in trying to think about, you know, what role could an institute play that could distinguish itself from a role a museum plays or a role that a gallery plays, is to try to build on both of those definitions of what an institute might be. This kind of, I think it's a wonderfully means everything and nothing kind of a word, and so I'm trying to kind of provide at least one possible definition to what that is. And so what I'm trying to do is, on one hand, to be an ICA and work in a very similar way to how Solveig is describing a kind of commission-based program of really trying to produce new work by individual artists and giving them the kind of attention and time that it takes to develop a conversation over 1 or 2 years to develop and generate a new body of work. But then at the same time to have a equally important parallel program, which is the kind of research institute think tank approach, which is to dedicate much a 6-month period to really trying to talk about, read about, write about one single artist, and for there to be a non-exhibition but event and publication-based program that really tries to sink our teeth much very deeply into an individual practice and relate it to a wider culture. And so that is trying to work with artists in a very distinct way. One, here's X amount of dollars to produce new work and X amount of square feet to show it. That's one thing that we're offering. But then to someone else, we're offering X amount of months of our sustained attention. And that takes a different form that is not exhibition-based. So that's kind of some of the ways in which exhibitions play and don't play a role in what potentially an institute might be.
Okay, I think that's very interesting for our talk, this notion of time. I think we will come back to this notion. I think it's crucial to the understanding of what a Kunsthalle Art Center Institute could do. Just, Matthew, you're running the White Columns in New York, and I think it plays a tremendous role in New York, which is, as you know, the center of the market. I know it when I arrive in New York in 2000 to run the Swiss Institute. You immediately realize you're in the middle of this like market world, and an art center has to play a role in this context. So I think the White Columns is playing an amazing role in New York. Working with artists. Can you tell us a little bit more about what you do with the artist and in the New York context?
Sure. I think the thing that interests me about spaces like White Columns, Artist Space, Printed Matter, The Kitchen, and a group of spaces in New York, but also nationally in the United States in the late 60s and early 1970s, they were described as alternative spaces for at least two decades. And I haven't been able to precisely identify when the term alternative stopped being used, but I think it's towards the end of the 1980s, the term just went out of favor or out of fashion. And it seemed to me that it was a perfect term for these organizations because their job was to provide an alternative, to the institutions of all scales and to the market. And I think, if you look at the histories of these organizations, including White Columns, they really did that. They created an art history that's still unfolding, but most of the art histories in New York City can be traced by one or two degrees of separation back to these organizations, the art history of the last 50 years. So it's interesting to me, it's like, when did that change and why did it change and how did these organizations become more bureaucratic? Why did they become more professional? Because there was a kind of not a degree of unprofessionalism, but it was kind of a lack of professionalism in these organizations in their earlier histories. And I think for me it's like, is it possible, necessary, or desirable to recover some of those ideas for these organizations? And I think when White Columns is at 112 Green Street in the 1970s, speaking of time, exhibitions last for 2 weeks. That was the duration of an exhibition. And I think it tells you something about the audience for that work too. The audience was very small, and the audience would see the work during the 2 weeks that it was on public view. But also I think it meant that the organization had a very different function, it had a very different momentum, it had a very different rhythm, and it had a very different kind of purpose. And for me at least, it's trying to think about if and how we can behave differently to everything else that's on offer in New York City right now. And then if that's possible, then how does one go about that? And I think also to speak to this question of how do you support that? Because in the United States, there's almost no governmental city or state support. It's supported mostly through private means of different kinds. And it's like, what does that mean then when you're trying to behave differently? And I think the thing that interests me most about an organization like White Columns, and I think White Columns is quite different to the other organizations we represent here, is that I think for the most part we're interested in art before consensus. I think if the function of the art world in its totality is really about the creation of consensus, about how we find ways to agree, and whether that's institutionally or commercially, it seems to me this process of creating consensus is the driving function of the art world. And I'm interested to see if you could actually work against or around that. And think about presenting work that exists before consensus as an opportunity to form around those ideas. So I think for the most part, a lot of the work we're trying to do is we're trying to show work that is largely untested, work that has almost zero critical histories, or work that somehow escaped or eluded critical histories or consensus. And for me, it's not a nostalgic attempt to recover what these organizations might have been, but it's trying to find a purpose for these organizations in the current conditions we all operate and work in.
Thank you. Coming back to this notion of time, I think we know that the difference, I would say, between what the artist needs and what the institution can do for them is sometimes, worth studying it. The artist has some speed, I would say. They have like more or less no constraints. They know what they want to do, and they go full speed toward the objective. they need support from institutions. I mean, when I say institution, it could also be a gallery, could be a museum, could be an art center. All these art institutions have their own constraints, their own speed, I would say. So I would say that between the speed of the artist and the speed of the art institution, there is some gap. And I think the one of the role of the director of an institution is to try to do anything he could to fill up this gap. So do you think the art institution, the art center, the Kunsthalle, is the best structure to do so, to be as close as the artist as we could do, or it's not like a specificity of the Kunsthalle? I'm trying to think about what's left in terms of identity or specificity for Kunsthalle. Do you think is it one of the aspects of the an art center, Samuel?
I think it's like Anthony said, and everybody mentioned a little bit, it depends what the focus is of the individual institution. I think some have very much rely on publications and on written outreach and event programs. It depends where you can dock in at the artist's needs at the time in their career. You know, the artists have different needs at different times in their development. And you know, at my space at Salz, we really try to focus just at the production and to help the artist create a work that's kind of still seems impossible for them to do at the time they're doing it. And since we're a small operation, we don't do a lot of other things that larger institutions do. So we don't have that sort of funding and that sort of infrastructure to then get the equal outreach press-wise and marketing-wise, but we can try to focus mostly on really trying to get over a certain burden in a certain artist's work where they feel maybe stuck or they feel like they don't have the context to yet show or mount a certain work. Mm-hmm. So I think all of us, like Matthew said, you know, everybody's trying to do something that's an additional contribution in the context of also the city that we're working in.
I think, Anthony, it's very interesting what you said about this, I would say, two different rhythms. You have the program rhythm with an exhibition every month, every 2 months, or it depends. And then you have this rhythm of like 6 months dedicated to one artist, which is, I think, a time which is hard to find, I would say, in another institution or even in an art or event-oriented structure. This could be seen maybe in a museum, of course. The time is more stretched in a museum to study the work, to study the collection. Is there another, I would say, time structure that is specific to art center?
I think what you said about the discrepancy between the way artists work and the time that they need to do what they do and institutions is, I think also speaks to what Matthew said about, you know, in the 70s, you know, the kind of initial beginning of the artist-run space had a very different relationship to time, because it was this way of artists to be able to share with each other what they were doing. And so it was things that were very event-based. It was very like, come over to my loft to see the performance I'm working on right now. And that essentially was, quote-unquote, the institutional space for where art was shared between people who are invested in this field. And it was done in a very kind of quick way in that sense, without all of the baggage of an institution, and then that becomes to become professionalized, and things, you know, get planned out a lot more in advance. But what's been interesting to me is that, yet despite in that context of this kind of much quicker improvisational type of let's just share what we're doing and in the same time that we're doing it by inviting people to my loft to, or starting an artist-run space to show it. I think we've come to a point now where there's just so much activity and so much, you know, next event, next show, this kind of conveyor belt problem, that the one of the main reasons that I've been convinced by this longer term is honestly by many conversations with artists who find it to be an extraordinary, and the experience that I've had, this extraordinary luxury for someone to call them up and say, you know, we'd like to gather around a group of people who are going to simply dedicate and commit 6 months to just talking about what you do, thinking about what you do, talking to you about what you do, and programming various events and publications, just continually repeat, you know, every month we're going to kind of have the perversity of repeating ourselves and tell our audience, hey, we're still thinking about this artist. And the next month, yes, here's another thing, and have that kind of, and that seems like it kind of goes against, on the surface, it feels like it goes against this very dynamic, live sense of the genesis of the alternative spirit, of it being much more live, so to speak. But speaking purely from conversations and experience from working in this way for the past several years, it's just been a very rewarding experience with artists who just say how unusual of a phone call it is to get, to be given 6 months of attention versus an invitation to do another event next week.
No. Thank you. Elena, do you want to add something? You've been a curator who is very interested also in the vertical, deep, historical links. So maybe, I don't know, do you have any comment on Anthony's thoughts?
Well, both about this question of time and what you've pointed out about the gap between how artists work and how institutions work. I think it's a bit of an illusion to think that all artists sort of need a certain kind of time. I mean, I think we're all here because we want to be able to figure out within our institutions how to give the artists that we're interested in the possibility to realize things that, it sounds a bit perhaps like a cliche, but what other institutional market, commercial event cultures can't seem to offer them, to be the niche, the alternative, if you will, between those offerings. But not all artists need the same thing. And some of them want to, actually, all of us perhaps also work with artists both that have galleries and some that don't. And so that they, in some cases, don't even have the alternative of, you know, going to a gallery and having every 1 or 2 years a regular show in a space with the kind of production means that offers. So it's interesting to be able to work with artists at different levels of, in their career, still relatively early in that career, and to find a modality in each case where they might need 1 year to prepare a project. I mean, in some cases, like my very first project for Kunsthalle Basel, a kind of inauguration, was to invite a young performance artist who is, I kind of staged or began to stage her very first institutional solo show, but it's a solo show that will take the entire duration of my time as director. So we made an agreement that this would be the beginning of her retrospective in reverse. And my predecessor was director for 11 years. I may be here for who knows how long, but it could potentially be a very long time. And it seemed, in relation to the very particular kind of work that she was making, the very particular needs that her performance, her very subtle, small gestured performance practice required, that it was interesting for us to think in the very long term about how to watch a young artist's career kind of develop over time, and how could she articulate in a way a program that could potentially take 11 years to develop, and how would a local audience also react to that, because they are potentially the only people who could keep coming back to see it year after year. Or, I mean, there's no rule for her retrospective in reverse. She has a carte blanche that she can call me at any moment and say, I've thought about it and this performance that I'm working on, or this performance I've already made a couple years ago, I believe it belongs in the retrospective. And then we figure out where to stage it, like which space, what, how much time it needs, and then we figure out when it will be staged. And that's not something I would do with many artists, or maybe any other artist. But it, that artist, that particular body of work, that way of thinking that was central to her practice seemed to require it. And other artists, you know, I've called them up 1 year. Well, I mean, I've been at the Kunsthalle 8 months, and as soon as I knew I would be director, even before I started, I was making phone calls and sort of giving artists as much time as possible to think what they would want to do in a space, because it was new for me as much as it would have been new for them. And I wanted to be able to think with them about how do we articulate something across the two very different spaces that are present in the Kunsthalle, and even the space that's not designated as exhibition space, that potentially the foyer or the stairs or the restaurant could be, you know, kind of occupiable if they should need it or want it.
Thank you. Solveig, any thought about this time structure, the artist needs, the Kunsthalle can do, sometimes the gap in between. Any thought about?
Yeah, well, I think that this consensus that you're talking about for the programming is also something that we should actually also avoid as for the institutional landscape, that we should avoid a consensus about what an institution should be and what an institution should serve, because that is exactly what our role is, to look at that as a very fragmented landscape. And we serve different things at different times, and that is the positive thing with working with institutions and forming institutions. And institutions are like muscles in the sense they train, they figure out, they get stronger in what they're doing. And I think that this gap that you're talking about, I think also there is there's something that is also a little healthy, that there is a gap between the artists and the institutions. Having experienced the new institutionalism in the Nordic country in the late 90s and the beginning of the 2000s, where we in the end ended up, which could be, I mean, it was a very important development, especially for the institutional scene in Scandinavia, where all of a sudden you had a much more open institutional model that started to influence how museums worked, and all of a sudden you had a much more alternative type of museums as well, influencing what the programs of museums. But at the same time, you also had institutions that in the end became artists themselves, that the blur between what was art, what was artist, what was curator, what was the institution became like, and they took the role somehow, I would say, like they became the artists themselves, which is not necessarily the healthy model, but it's something that also we learned a lot from, because from there we got a completely different discursiveness. We dealt with art in a different way, and I think that's that kind of flexibility that we should train, that to walk with the artists and try to have that conversation and be as close as we can, but still the artist is the artist, and there will always be a distance between us. What I think is important though, and is the word non-for-profit in this context, is that it's important that institutions, no matter what they are, if they're, you know, alternative or more art centers, or that they are able to support the artists also for this commissioning and production. Because what I see is that producing in a gallery and producing in a non-for-profit institution creates different kinds of work. And that's what I see, that I feel like the Renaissance Society do have a role. We can produce work that, I mean, if that goes to the market, or if we tear it and trash it all down after the show is over, we don't mind any of those outcomes. So that's a freedom that you would have in a non-for-profit institution that might not be there. I'm not saying that it's not necessarily always like that, but it might not be there in a gallery or market or commercial context. So I think that is an important task we can have.
Matthew, speaking about blurring boundaries, you're a curator, a director, but you're also an artist, a writer. How do you feel about when someone say there is a gap between what the artist wants and what the institution can do?
Yeah, I mean, I think I think that's a responsibility of myself at White Columns is to, as I said before, behave differently. And consequently, I think in order to do that, you know, you have to think about what's already being addressed, how it's being addressed, and who it's being addressed by, and then start to think about the things that actually fall outside of those kind of narratives. And, you know, I think consequently, I'd say 25% of the programming at White Columns is supporting artists with mental and developmental disabilities and presenting their work within the context of other forms of contemporary art. And I think that's one way of thinking about a space that isn't being necessarily addressed on a larger scale and, you know, in more diverse places. But I think, you know, the thing that I think perhaps surprises me more than anything is the extent to which, and I include White Columns, is that we all behave the same. That we keep the same hours, we follow the same paths, we use the same kind of structures, we're implicated in the same systems of distribution and so forth. And it seems to me that, again, not to be nostalgic, but it seems to me that before, places like the kitchen and so on were more disruptive. That they functioned differently, but they also were disruptive in the culture. And consequently, new cultural forms emerged from that process of disruption. And, you know, I wonder whether it's feasible or possible to be disruptive anymore. And if so, how do we actually go about doing that? And if that's even something, again, that's desirable. But for me, it is. It seems to me that the point or purpose of art is to be disruptive, and it seems that the purpose of the institutions that present art of all kinds need to be disruptive relative to their audiences, so the take can be disruptive to a mass audience, just as White Columns can be disruptive to a more focused audience. And it seems to me it's how do you institutionalize that? And it's like, how do you create an economic and a bureaucratic and administrative structure around disruption, which seems to be an anathema as an idea. It seems to be working against that. And so it seems to me, at least in the context of the, you know, running White Columns, it's trying to think about perhaps how it used to behave and how we might behave in the present tense. And I think one of the interesting things I'm interested in relation into time is how long you work at a place. So not so much about artist time, but about directorial, curatorial time. And the Renaissance Society is perhaps the greatest example, with Suzanne Goetz spending 40 years within one institution. And I think that interests me more than artists' time. It interests me about how long does it take to actually change the culture inside an organization, and how long does it take for that culture to be legible to audiences, and then how long does it take for that those changes to actually start to affect and change the nature of visual culture itself. And I think it takes an enormous amount of time. And I think that sort of culture in the 90s and early 2000s, where everybody was changing jobs every 3 years, so you arrive, you do some programming, you leave, that seems to have completely slowed down. And all of the curators pretty much that emerged in the sort of 1990s independent culture, independent curators narrative, are almost all institutionalized now. So what happens when those kind of curatorial initiatives become institutionalized, and why do the institutions remain somewhat predictable or conservative even, when in fact the ideas being articulated aren't necessarily those things? So it's that idea, is it possible to be disruptive? And then within that, that seems to occupy some of these interstitial spaces, these gaps.
Thank you. I think it's you point out a very important issue, the power of be disruptive. And I think it's something any curator in Kunsthalle is or should be aware of. I mean, especially if we want to be in sync with artists we want to present. So is this question about institutionalization and being disruptive, is it? I mean, now we have a little bit. Is it a little bit the end? So we can be a little bit more like trying to make wish list or think about the future. And any wish list or any wishes about or prediction for Kunsthalle? Speaking about the future of Kunsthalle, if you had like a white page, you could start from scratch an institution, and with this in mind, with this ability to be disruptive, what could it be? is it something we could add to the structure of Kunsthalle that would help us to be more disruptive, less risks of being institutionalized? I don't know. I just thinking loud, Anthony.
Well, of course, unfortunately, I'm from a city where that word is unusable because it's on every single billboard that separates San Francisco from Silicon Valley. And they've essentially hijacked the use of that word. And so to be disruptive is something you really do not want to be, because it really basically means that you are completely part of a logic and a way of thinking that is perverse beyond means with regards to commercial applications and the new way that the word even creative is used in that context. But, you know, I honestly don't know, you know, I've been struggling a lot with, you know, because that is a word that I've relied on for many years, and now I find myself in a situation where I can't use that word or words like it, think different, you know, et cetera. You just can't use any of this language. And so, you know, how to create something, you know. My sense is that there's fundamental assumptions that institutions rely on to determine the degree to which they're successful, and the kind of traditional institutional answers to that question, what are those criteria, have to do with just by looking at what institutions essentially how they're behaving in terms of as they're trying to consider themselves successful, has something to do with how visible they can be, how, you know, large they can become, how much audience they can generate. And so I would almost start with those three criteria as criteria to challenge and to second guess about, is that how we're going to define success of what an institution is? And if you go against that, or if you try to poke some holes into that line of thinking, then potentially that can be one way of being disruptive. But just as a last thing, I think it's important to keep in mind that, you know, if I started with a blank page, I think it's very dangerous to write "be disruptive" on the top of it, because that's something that you can't really kind of program and plan out and then execute, like, you know, here's the recipe and push play. You know, I think these are the kinds of things that you need to rely on, the organic ways in which artists disagree with each other, and as a way for those contradictions to accumulate, and disruption happens in that less programmatic way.
Thank you, Anthony. Solveig, any wishes for a new structure or rethinking the Kunsthalle structure?
I don't know if it's wish. I guess it's a question that I'm maybe asking myself, and I'm wondering about it, if the Kunsthalle or if the institutions that we're talking about here, also in addition to what our main task is obviously to, you know, present artworks, create frames around those artworks. But at the same time, I feel that we're, you know, looking very much inside. I wonder if institutions, art institution, can take a more social role in society today, like sociopolitical. Are we able, do we have the muscles needed to actually be relevant for the broader society? Can we actually, you know, contribute with something? I mean, the content that we present in these artworks are certainly dealing with the world out there and its complexity. Are we as institutions able to deal with the same complexity and not only sort of preserving or framing that content? But it's something I don't know necessarily the further task to do it, but it's a question that I'm asking.
Thank you. Elena, any thoughts about these structures?
Well, certainly it's something I'm struggling quite a lot with. I mean, being the newbie, the new to a old institution, I have just come from an institution that when WHEELS, Center for Contemporary Art in Brussels, where when I arrived, it was just 1 year old, and it was in a place that wasn't the center of the art world, that was in a kind of disused post-industrial space. And although it may seem like details, those, that combination of facts, its newness, its not being in Paris or London or New York, meant that we sort of felt collectively as an institution that everything was possible, and that there was no expectation, and thus through that project tried to define not only how to defend young artists who, you know, had not yet indeed entered a question of consensus, but also forgotten figures or older historical figures that also had somehow slipped through the gaps, and to try to find also other measures for what institutional success would be. And I totally agree with Anthony in that regard. And now coming to an institution that has a quite different, very long institutional history, where for a very long time, its success has been measured according to looking in the history books and understanding that it gave Gauguin the first show in Switzerland in 1928, or Matisse a very important show in 31, and that these are now names that have become household names. And of course, that is one measure for what an institution should do, because at that very moment, there weren't necessarily, the museums were not yet showing those figures and not yet giving them the space. And then it goes through, you know, time to the present, that we can look back at the institutional history of Kunsthalle Basel and say that, you know, these artists who are now established were shown before they were so. But, and of course, that's I guess something to be very proud of, but I'm also interested in exactly those figures that we still have never heard of, and that an institution in real time took risks on artists, or, it's not really a risk, but, you know, decided to engage itself, invest itself in making exhibitions, or conceiving also what an exhibition could be with an artist, giving them a platform without the idea of a return on the investment, because it's not commercial, because it's a non-for-profit space, and because the mission is to be a place of the now, of the present, that allows artists to articulate something in their very particular individual means. And so the shows in the history of the Kunsthalle also had very different lengths. When I look back at the old posters, I realize indeed some shows were 2 weeks and some lasted 1 month and some much longer. And it seemed that that could be defined by the needs of the project. And I think that's really interesting. I mean, there was a project unrealized for a museum for contemporary art in Skopje, Macedonia. And Oscar Hansen, this kind of avant-garde Polish architect who proposed the proposal, built the museum in such a way that it had galleries that could sink into the ground at the moment when it was not necessary to make an exhibition, and that they could be raised, and then from the city you could see, the exhibition gallery's up, it means there's a show on. But his reasoning for that was, you know, we don't need to have exhibitions all the time, always on, because there isn't always something to say with the same loudness. And maybe we should imagine institutions, not that we're closing down exhibitions or we're closing our doors, but that we can imagine different temporalities, different possibilities for exhibitions based on the need of the moment, of the space, of the city, of the artist, of the project.
It has to do with freedom as well. Freedom to do something or not do something, or do something differently in a smaller space or bigger space.
Yes, which maybe museums would have a harder time with, because perhaps, although we are all somehow institutionalized and we all have various levels of bureaucracy, even across this stage, somehow there is, we hope, still a lighter version of that than many of the institutions that are still require that they have to, that an artist would have to occupy X number of square meters for X amount of time and have, you know, exactly 3 cocktail conversations with, you know, the X number of trustees in order for a project to be realized, and it takes a certain time and follows a certain protocol. So if being disruptive is not only a possibility in thinking about our program, maybe it's also a possibility in terms of how we structurally organize what we do in small and big ways.
Thank you. Samuel, maybe I think we should end a little bit here before giving the floor to the audience. Do you think you have you're running the space which is the younger, I would say, among all these people here? Do you think you feel the pressure a little bit differently, or the disruptive element could be more present, or the risk of institutionalization is smaller, lighter? What do you think about being the director of the, I would say, the younger art space here?
Well, I thought personally it was fascinating to hear everybody's core motivation here on the panel of their respective institutions. I think I have the luxury for having been able to really choose to start at the very smallest point and to build something up to which is now quite an extensive programming. But what I think is interesting now also hearing everybody in comparison to what was in the synopsis of the talk today about the speed of things and about the disintegration of the artwork and the dematerialization of the space. I think it's just fascinating to actually hear that exactly the opposite is happening, you know, that everybody's actually really, it's all about defining your own niche with the background of where we're all based, you know. So everybody's here offering something very unique against the backdrop of the institution they're working in, you know. And you're working with now a very historical, loaded institution, and it gives you certain luxuries, and of course it gives certain pressure to younger artists having to show there. And I think it's just interesting to hear that I think we're always talking these days about blurring the lines and crossing over, but I think fact is just that we're living in a multidisciplinary time now, and we're trying to all find a way of putting it under one roof in our respective roofs, you know, with a slightly different, you know, motivation and goal within it. So I find it fascinating.
Yeah, thank you. I think it's time now to see if there is any question. I'm sure there are some questions among the audience. Any question?
Good morning.
Morning.
Well, sorry, my English is terrible. you were talking about that an artist not always has something to say with the same intensity. And what about the importance of a CV in an artist? I mean, what's the real importance for an artist to have a CV, to have won a lot of awards, to have been studying in a top university or not? What do you think about that?
You mean the importance of the background, mm-hmm. education in art school, versus an artist who is self-taught?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, I think it's an interesting question. Maybe the world specialist is here. You've been working with a lot of self-taught artists, and also, of course, with educated.
Certainly, from my experience. And I imagine it's different, say, if you're a curator at the Tate Gallery or something, that we can basically do whatever we want, literally, as long as we can find ways to support what we want to do. So we can literally do anything. What always surprises me is that when I travel to different places is that everything feels familiar or similar. It's very rare to encounter things that are just wildly idiosyncratic or genuinely maverick, or just flat out strange. We've created a kind of evenness in our experience of how we encounter visual culture, and I'm sure this kind of evenness is similar in other fields too. You know, I'm old enough to remember when I come from England, and music from Manchester sounded different from music from Sheffield, which sounded different from music from Leeds. And of course, that doesn't happen in the same way anymore, and we can't go back to that time. But I do think we can show anything. And we don't have to show work that's been, you know, accumulated consensus. We don't have to show work that's been filtered through the market. We don't have to show work that's been filtered or circulated within other kind of existing structures. We can basically do whatever we want. And I'm surprised how relatively few places just behave strangely. And so to address your question, you know, I think it's, of course, artists accumulate histories as they exhibit and as they show and as they get older. And those histories become, you know, wider known and more widely accepted. And that's really consensus is what you're talking about. And the flip side of that is the artist with no resume, which means no consensus. And then, of course, that work has no critical baggage yet or institutional histories. And what does it mean to present that in public space? It's like, how do you frame that? How do you explain that? How do you articulate why it might be interesting when nobody else has said it's interesting yet? And they're very different things, I think. I think, you know, White Calms, there are very few people, I think, will get up in the morning, cross town on public transport, to come to White Calms to see an exhibition by an artist they've never heard of. There are very few people willing to do that. And it's the same for experimental poetry, it's the same for experimental theater, it's the same for experimental anything. There's a very tiny audience of people who are willing to cross town to see things they've never heard of or never seen before. And then by the time those ideas find their way to the new museum or to the Museum of Modern Art, there's a different audience for those ideas. It's bigger and it's different. So I guess the thing, the audience I'm interested in is that first audience, is the audience who will cross town to see something they haven't heard about before, which is what I used to do when I was younger, and it's what I, you know, try to do as an older person. So I'm interested to the person that asked the question, I can't see because of the lights, but I'm interested in the artist with no resume.
Thoughts, anyone on this self-taught or, sorry, Mike, for an artist, does it make any difference for you? No? No difference. Okay. I think we have another question here.
Yeah. Raymond Sanner from Geneva. I'd like to build on what Matthew just said. And the idea that something is possible at a small scale, which he describes at his place, my question would be how to scale up what is unique, you call it disruption or creative or whatever you want to call it, that would fit with the challenges that we all face, and it's being discussed at the high level, at the United Nations. We're talking about sustainable development goals, about the environmental crisis that we have, but social crisis as well. You know, in other words, if we cannot scale up the message of art and the contribution of art or through culture, sorry for being a bit blunt, but what's the relevance of what you ladies and gentlemen are doing in light of the challenges that we face for the future? Can you provide some good, positive, constructive disruption, or will it be more of the same? Thank you.
Thank you for this question. Solveig?
Oh yeah, that's exactly my question too. And I guess we just have to ask those questions to ourselves. I think that one answer is not to scale up physically, that's for sure, meaning this is not about size, this is not about physical size, and I do not believe in that institution needs to be big and have physical space that is demanding. But I do believe that we need probably to scale up our belief in that actually art can say something, and that we can contextualize these exhibitions in a way where we create conversations. And that's, I guess, the best we can hope for, that we can actually contribute to a conversation. We can be a voice in these issues together with the artists. And it also, I think, has to do with opening up the institutions, that it's not only about art for art's sake in that sense, and market, and you know what work is hot at the moment, and what which art is hot at the moment. But actually, that we take the time to discuss what it is that these, what art actually communicates. And I then believe also, now I experience being running an institution at the University of Chicago, and it's amazing how many possibility lies there right outside our door at the university, with scholars, thinkers, academics who really have something to say about topics that we raise in these exhibitions. And maybe that's one way to go deeper, not broader and wider and bigger, but actually deeper, and allow ourselves to be. And also then we have to dare to address the difficulty. I mean, there's a lot of difficult topics that we have to allow ourselves to talk about, and also open up the stage for those topics to be addressed. And I think that's a challenge, and I think that we also need to challenge ourselves as institutional leaders to open up for that conversation.
Thank you, Elena.
Well, I quite agree, but and I would also say that, I mean, it seems in response to your question, you might want to know whether or not we're programming artists who might concretely or directly tackle larger global issues. And, you know, sometimes we are, and often, you know, often when we aren't, I still think that as institutions invested not only in, you know, and again, we're struggling for the word, whether it's creative or disruptive or unconventional or means of showing art and providing platforms for artists, I think all of us are involved in trying to think about how to accompany the various projects we do with the possibility of, you know, helping to nurture an audience that become critical thinkers, critical readers of images. And I think that as soon as you have a public which is a more critical reader or reader of images, it allows the possibility of reading more critically the images that were thrown at us every day in the media, on television, in the newspaper. I just can't help think of, I worked on an exhibition some years ago of Felix Gonzalez Torres, and reading interviews about him and transcripts of his lectures and essays about him, I was amazed by this very first lesson he gave as a teacher to his students. He would always send them home. It was a photography class. And he would always send them home not to come back with a photograph or a subject for photography, but rather an article from the New York Times that they could take apart, that they could show was false or inherently fiction, a lie, in exactly that most incontrovertible source and authority that is the New York Times. And I thought, as an artist, his first mission was maybe to make his students start to doubt, to question authority of his their teacher, first and foremost, but everything around them. And I think that artists have been, you know, one of my sort of greatest teachers and inspirations for what I do. But maybe that's also, in whatever scale institution I've worked at, one of the things that I've tried to take also as a mission, like maybe the first task is to make your audience begin to question the authority of, you know, of various structures, whatever they may be, to start to doubt and to come back, not necessarily with the New York Times, but with whatever it is, and not assume that it is necessarily the truth or the whole truth.
Thank you. Any other question?
Yes, I have a question, please. Can one of you be more specific about this idea of non-profit institutions? Because I'm wondering, in what way is private money, I mean, in what way does it provide more freedom than public money, for instance? And I'm saying it in view of the fact that in Western democracies, we know quite well that often government money is supported or infiltrated by private money. So what if you could be more specific or more concrete about what lies behind this idea of non-profit?
Well, I think I think it's simple. You know, non-for-profit is, there is no profit made with what you exhibit, no? I mean, it's as simple as that. I mean, if the work is sold, the usual thing to do is normally, you know, the institution is reimbursed at the height of the production cost. It's more or less what's done in non-for-profit. But the non-for-profit means it could be like public money and private money. I mean, it depends on the structure. Sometimes it's 40% to see versus 60% of private. I am not sure about your question, or did I miss something? You maybe it's about, is the question about non-for-profit?
No, I meant my question actually was focused on the idea of what are the sources for the activities of such institutions. I mean, who supports these activities? Money is not neutral.
Normally, a non-for-profit is typically a certain percentage of public money and private money coming from different foundation, coming from benefit dinner, auction, corporate drive, all that kind of tools to raise funds. No?
Well, I think the question is, I mean, maybe I'm misinterpreting, but I think the connotation is, for example, in the political context where, you know, people fundraising, that money gotten from private sources has strings attached, and therefore to what degree do those strings play a role in privately raised funds that nonprofit institutions
you see this Tate Modern in London with the sponsorship of BP. It's been, you know, hugely controversial, and now the activists trying to stop that support of Tate Modern by BP are creating works, performative interventions inside Tate Modern in relation to that. I thought the question was, and I thought it's a really interesting question, is there a greater degree of freedom working in a not-for-profit context and a greater degree of freedom, say, than Conrad Fisher Gallery? And I'm not sure there is. You know, it's very complicated about how we, you know, what we claim as freedom. In relation to the economics of it, a fellow director of another not-for-profit organization in New York, his board said that he was spending too much money. And he said, that's my job, is to lose money. And I thought that was one nice way of sort of addressing the sort of economic imperatives. But I think it's much more complex. And to the larger question about what can we actually do socially and politically, you know, I think if one of the greatest problems we all face is income inequality, then it's very complicated for us to discuss that within the framework of contemporary visual culture, because contemporary visual culture is so extraordinarily implicated to a degree it never was in the narratives of income inequality. So I think it's interesting for me to think, say, about artist-run spaces in the Bay Area in the 1970s. They were very activist. They were very kind of adversarial. And they're very political, and similarly to different degrees in New York City, in a way that we're not now. And why aren't we? And should we be? And if we should be, how can we be? And what would a structure around those ideas look like? It probably wouldn't look like the current artist space or the current white columns or the current printed matter. But then to go back onto that, the ideas that germinated in these spaces and spaces like them internationally in the late 60s and early 1970s radically changed culture. And in changing culture, they obviously changed people's opinions and positions, and they radically changed the larger institutions. So now we see huge museums behaving in the ways that these organizations behaved 30 or 40 years ago, assimilating and adopting programmatic structures into the context of the museum in ways that really didn't happen, say, in the 1980s and 1970s. So it's complicated, obviously, and I think it's a very good question, because it gets to the heart of the problem. And my only answer to your question is that we can, and perhaps should, behave differently. We don't have to subscribe to the larger narrative of the status quo or the way things are. I think, you know, for example, the
biennial culture seems to be exhausted, and I think the political, socio-political, economic implications of what biennials are and how they function in certain places, I think is really, it's an exhausted model now. And they just, I think in 10 years there won't be as many. And I think that's a change. And I think we can change too, if that we see that that's part of our current narrative. And so consequently, certainly to speak very personally, my support of artists that don't participate in this economy is a way of behaving differently. It's not the only way, obviously, but it's a way of behaving differently.
I mean, I think both questions, I mean, I think, of course, speak to each other. And I think they're both very important questions as well. I mean, I guess I completely agree with what both Matthew and Elena were saying just about, you know, yeah, to put it the way you put it, this critical thinking, the idea that what we can hopefully do rather than scaling up per se, or again, oh, we will succeed if we manage to reach this amount of thousands of people because that will make it likely for us to affect a larger conversation, is to, potentially just, you know, disagree with the way in which culture is potentially instrumentalized that way or put at the service of change in that explicit way, and to trust the fact that if artists are allowed to have spaces of autonomy outside of those pressures, whether it's a marketplace or whether it's, you know, the explicit outcome desired by an activist related project, if one is free to from that, that a lot can come from that. Again, going back and not wanting to be too nostalgic, but going back to the kind of self-selected audience of people sharing ideas in a loft context, you know, 40 years later, that's generated, now you have the Museum of Modern Art doing retrospectives of performance artists. And it does generate change in the way in which people think about culture. But I agree that it's good to point out, you know, that the relationship between what does it mean to support disagreement and how does that map itself onto the private individuals we're going to rely on who are going to essentially write checks so that we disagree with them. Because that's essentially what we're asking. You know, the kind of sales pitch to make to these private individuals, if one is trying to do the projects that we're doing, is saying, listen, would you agree to support us, you know, to in some way reject fundamental assumptions about the way the culture is organized and what you value? Will you go to bat for that with us? And it's somehow there's enough people who that's why we have to stay small. I mean, yeah, scale is another organization. I mean, there's, you know, I don't know if this is true, but I think that the Museum of Modern Art in New York actually, maybe you know this, explicitly does not take any public money, because they don't want the enormous amount of strings that come with spending tax dollars and the potential repercussions of doing something. They just kind of made the calculation that it is not worth the trouble to try to get what is ultimately a limited amount of money, and therefore the entirety of their fundraising approach is private. And what is that? Yeah, what does that mean with regards to its relationship to again, at that scale, to culture at large?
Also, culture has a very different role in a civic sense in the United States than it does in Europe, where Kunsthalle Basel is clearly a hub in this community, intellectually, socially, psychologically, historically, whereas cultural institutions of all kinds, I think, just occupy a very different place in terms of the civic image and idea in the United States. Because I think our funding from city, state, and government is less than 5% of our budget. So it's not the 40 or 60% you're talking about here. So the rest comes from somewhere else.
Any question? Yeah.
Yes, hi, hello. Thank you for sharing all of your insights. My name is Samuel Salmakers. I work as a curator at Øvstebø Center for Contemporary Art, which is very much also, I guess, a Kunsthalle model. In the past few years, we've also engaged with projects on a long-term base. So both of them, one with Alexander Singh, one with Heman Chong, lasted about 2 years. And I was curious about your experiences with these kind of projects, if there is such a thing as giving too much time to a project, or how do you avoid it bleeding out? And also, how do you negotiate the pleasure and indulgence we in the art world might have, or professionals might have, in these long-term engagements, because we all love open-endedness, and it's great fun working with artists that way. But how do you negotiate that with the interests of an audience, and how do you make sure these people, with all their varying interests and attention spans, how do you make sure they actually get something out of this as well? Where does it, you know, what's the balance to find between those two approaches?
I'll just say from it, my experience that the shows we will open in September, the White Calms, we started organizing them last week, like deciding what to show. So three of the five shows are organized and two remain completely unknown. But the three others were resolved last week and were decided on 2 weeks ago. So that's our speed, but I appreciate Anthony has different speed.
I mean, you know, there's institutions all over the world that the entire institution is based on a single artist. You know, I mean, the Tingley Museum, or I mean, this is a program that is entirely based on trying to create residents with one position, and the whole organization is status quo. You know, I mean, I'm a firm believer in the general exists within the specific, rather than the other way around. The idea that, you know, to take a particular artist or a particular, you know, Hinan Chong or whoever as a specificity, that within that you can, there is an infinite amount of kind of diverse spirals that one can generate at. There's a generative nature to anchoring that and dedicating oneself to that specificity that can create a very dynamic and very flexible and very contradictory and very wide-ranging series of associations to other artists, of philosophers, poetry, music, blah blah blah, and you can create something that's very dynamic and very different, you know, involving people who might have never even heard of Hinan Chong, for example. And you know, you can give an audience aspect and access to a whole wide range of cultural propositions that's kind of generated out of the specificity of what the starting point was.
Thank you. Maybe we have one last question.
I'm interested to ask the people on this panel how important it is to be a global institution, and if it is important, how do you translate that to a local audience? Because most of, especially Samuel, for example, how important is that to you?
Samuel?
Well, I think what we hear is always the importance of the local work that has to be done of each institution. I mean, you really draw the artist under conversation and you try to root it down to a specific problem and confrontation at the respective institution. And then I think, so the local work is in the first place. The deeper you go with the work locally, the more it's going to radiate globally. So I think the successes of these various institutions that you hear about and read about is about the drive that's sitting right there in the institution itself. So I think it's one is connected to the other, and it's really based on the leadership that's that's happening in the place. So.
Thank you. Any other comment? Otherwise, we'll end up here. Thank you very much for your attention. And thank you all for your comments. And have a nice Sunday. Thank you for coming so early. And have a great afternoon here in Basel, at Basel, or any other exhibition, so many exhibitions here in museum and Kunsthalle and other art centers here in Basel. Thank you.